Now, will you turn in your Bibles to the 25th chapter of the book of Exodus? Exodus chapter 25, and I shall read a few verses from the beginning of this chapter. Exodus 25, 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, that they bring me an offering. Of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart, ye shall take my offering. Now skip over to verse 8. And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them. According to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle, and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it. The only building ever constructed upon this earth, which was perfect from its very beginning, and its very outset in every detail, and never again needed attention, addition, alteration, or repairs, was the tabernacle in the wilderness. The blueprint, the pattern, and the plan, the design, and all of the specifications were minutely made in heaven and then committed by God through Moses in Mount Sinai in behalf of the children of Israel. Every single detail was designed by Almighty God. Every part has a prophetic, redemptive, and a typical significance. There is not a single portion of Scripture richer in meaning, more perfect in its teaching of the plan of redemption, no clearer portrait of the Lord Jesus Christ than this divinely designed building. God Himself was the architect, and every detail points to some aspect of the character and the work and the person of His Son, Jesus Christ. And in its complete form, it is probably the most comprehensive, detailed revelation of the Son of God and the plan of salvation in the entire Old Testament. Now, this tabernacle in the wilderness was not an imposing structure as seen from the outside, and its unattractive exterior gave but little hint of its inner glory and exquisite beauty. The stranger, viewing it from the outside, would see none of the exquisite beauty, the breathtaking splendor of its glorious interior. Only after one had entered through the door at the eastern end of this building, and had stopped to sacrifice at the altar of burnt offering, had washed his hands and feet at the laver, could one enter to behold the interior of this most magnificent house of God. Before taking you into some of the glories of the interior of this building, we would first of all have you get a clear mental picture of the structure as a whole. Imagine, therefore, first of all, a rectangular plot of ground, 75 feet wide by 150 feet long. This is the size of a good-sized city lot. This rectangular lot or plot of ground was enclosed by a white fence 7.5 feet high, surrounding it on three sides, the north, the south, and the west. At the eastern end of this enclosure was the gate of the court, the only means of entrance into this sacred holy area. This gate was 30 feet wide, all the rest being enclosed by this white linen fence suspended like a curtain on brazen pillars, the pillars themselves resting upon a solid foundation of brazen sockets. Now, this enclosure was called the Court of the Gentiles, or the Outer Court. This court, with its one door, always had to face to the east, toward the rising of the sun. For it was a clear, unmistakable type of Him, and pointed forward to Him who is the Son of Righteousness, the Lord Jesus Christ. At the eastern end of this court, just inside the gate or the door, stood a brazen altar, and just behind this altar, to the west, stood the brazen laver, or the wash basin, containing water for the cleansing of the worshippers before they could enter into the holy place of the tabernacle. These, then, the altar and the laver, were the only two items of furniture in this open, roofless court in which stood the tabernacle proper. Now, the tabernacle itself, the building itself, was a flat-roofed, rectangular, tent-like building located at the western end of this open enclosure, which we have already described and referred to as the outer court. It was a portable building, 15 feet wide, 15 feet high, and 45 feet long, about the size of an extra-large living room. This space, 45 by 15 by 15, was divided into two unequal compartments. The front room, facing the east, was 30 feet long, 15 feet wide, and 15 feet high. This was called the holy place, or the first sanctuary. The rear room, separated by a veil from the holy place, was in the shape of a perfect cube, 15 by 15 by 15 feet, and this was called the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place. In the holy place, the larger of these two rooms, were three pieces of furniture, a dining table on the north side, a lampstand on the south side, and between these and slightly to the rear was the altar of incense. In the smaller room, called the Holy of Holies, and behind the veil which hid them from view, stood the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat above it. There were thus exactly seven pieces of furniture, speaking of the perfection of him to which all of this pointed. Every part of this building, every article of furniture, pointed to some aspect of the perfection of the personality and the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, our only meeting place with God, our tabernacle. These articles of furniture were so arranged that if we draw a straight line from the brazen altar at the door at the eastern end to the Ark of the Covenant in the Holy of Holies, bisecting the incense altar, and then draw another line at right angles to this one from the dining table on the north side to the lamp on the south, we have the perfect figure of a cross. For all of this speaks of one thing, the beginning and the end of our salvation and the work of Christ performed for us upon the cross of Calvary. The furniture of the tabernacle was all made of the finest gold, its hangings, its curtains and coverings of the most exquisite needlework in white linen and gold and purple and blue and scarlet. The walls of this building were made of gold-plated upright boards, which stood vertically, each one upon two sockets of silver. The boards, made of acacia wood, were completely covered with gold, each board 15 feet long and 2.5 feet wide. There were 20 boards each for the two long sides of the tabernacle, and 6 boards for the western end or wall. These boards stood on end. They stood upright, next to one another, and resting in their silver sockets, these sockets being embedded in the desert sand. These upright boards were then further united by 5 horizontal gold-plated bars which passed through golden loops attached to the boards from end to end, thus uniting them all into one solid, rigid wall. The inside of the tabernacle, therefore, was decorated with solid gold on all of its sides. Now, the roof of this building, this tabernacle, was made of 4 layers of cloth and leather. First, on the inside, and thus forming the ceiling of the tabernacle, and the only one of the 4 coverings visible from within, was the linen blanket, beautifully embroidered with gold, purple, blue, and scarlet, with embroidered figures of cherubim looking down upon the worshiper. This linen sheet covered the tabernacle first. Over this linen covering, which formed the ceiling of the tabernacle proper, was next draped a covering of cloth made of goat's hair, slightly overlapping the linen curtains. And over this of goat's hair was draped a 3rd layer, a covering of ram skins, leather, dyed a bright red. And over this one, and forming the outer covering, was a 4th great curtain of leather made of badger skins, drab, gray, unimpressive, unappealing, but water and weather repellent. Now in our coming messages, we shall go into detail concerning the meaning and the typical teaching of all of these various parts, their construction and their arrangement. But in this opening and introductory message, we want you, first of all, to get the overall picture. That is, a clear image in your mind of the general structure, the general looks of this curious building and its arrangement. Now, most of you will find a diagram of the tabernacle in the back of your Bibles. And I suggest that you study this diagram very carefully so that you'll have a good mental picture of the entire building. Now, to the stranger who stood on the outside of this building, he would see only 2 things, just 2 things. The white linen fence surrounding the court and the top part or roof of the tabernacle itself. Now, since the top or the roof was covered with a leather curtain of very drab gray badger skins, the outsider could, of course, see none of the inner beauty within. There was not a single hint to the viewer on the outside of the breathless, exquisite beauty which met the eyes of those who had gained entrance through the door and by the way of the altar. The person on the outside represents the sinner without Christ, the natural man without salvation in the wilderness of sin. The priest on the inside represents the believer who has passed through the door and appropriated the blood of the sacrifice at the altar and has been washed by the water of the word in the brazen laver. He can truly be said to be in Christ, for the tabernacle is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. Both the sinner on the outside and the saint on the inside see Christ, but how differently they behold him. The sinner, the man on the outside, sees the linen fence, to be sure, but this linen fence bars his entrance to the tabernacle, and it keeps him on the outside. He sees the badger skins also, but they are drab and gray and unattractive and dull. Now, the white linen speaks of Christ's perfect righteousness as expressed in the law. White linen speaks of righteousness in Scripture wherever it is used. And this the unregenerate man can easily see. Even the infidel and the unbeliever and the skeptic admit, they must admit the perfections of the Lord Jesus Christ morally. The unregenerate student of the Bible sees and admits that Christ was not an ordinary man. He admires his ideal moral character. He may extol his wisdom and teaching, but he doesn't see anything of his deity, of his virgin birth, of his atonement, his precious blood, resurrection, or the coming again. This only the believer who has entered the gate is able to see. Until a man therefore is born again, he cannot see. He cannot see in Christ anything more than his perfect humanity, his moral perfections, and his suffering, but will remain totally blind to the spiritual perfections of our Savior and the wonders of the book. But beside the linen curtain, the outsider also sees the dark, drab, dull, badger skin roof of the tabernacle proper. This is Christ in his humanity, the visible part of the Lord, in which he was clothed while he was here upon the earth. It is his humanity exposed to the desert storms of hate, reviling, and abuse of mankind. Isaiah says of this humanity of Christ, he hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Isaiah 53:2. Here indeed is a picture of the sinner and his view of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible further says that the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. 1 Corinthians 2:14. And again, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the eyes of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. 2 Corinthians 4:4. But there was one way to enter this tabernacle and behold its inner glory, but only one way. It was through the one and only gate which stood before the altar of sacrifice. The white linen of God's perfect righteousness prohibited the sinner from ever approaching God in his own goodness and morality and righteousness. But there was, nevertheless, a way, thank God, through the door, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. Our Savior himself said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. Again, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me, John 14:6. And when the sinner enters that door, he comes face to face first with the altar of burnt offering, perfect picture of the cross where the Lord Jesus made atonement for our sin. And then he will next take you to the laver of cleansing, to wash away all that sin. And then only can one enter through the veil into his presence, to feed at his table, to walk in the light of the golden candlestick, and learn to minister to others at the golden incense altar. The tabernacle, therefore, was both inclusive and exclusive. It excluded all those who refused to come by the one and the only door. The linen fence barred the access to the sinner as long as he had one single sin upon him. As long as there was a single spot of imperfection in his being, he was prohibited from approaching the tabernacle, but was barred by the perfect demands of God's holy righteousness and God's holy law. Access could only be gained by coming through faith through the door and appropriating the blood of the substitute slain upon the altar, and then he can truly be said to be in Christ, in Christ. As the tabernacle excluded the sinner, so it was inclusive for the believer and makes him absolutely safe and secure because he is shut in with God himself. As Noah himself was shut in by God and God himself closed the door, so to those who by faith come to the Lord Jesus, they are shut in. And of them he says in John 10:28, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." My friend, have you ever come by that door? You may stand outside, be religious, admire Christ as a perfect man, worship his goodness, acknowledge him as the great teacher, accept his moral and ethical teachers, and admire his virtues and graces. But until you come alone as a poor lost sinner and appropriate the blood of faith, there is no hope and no salvation. And so before we come to the close of this broadcast, we would like to lay upon your heart the necessity of coming by way of the door. Beloved, God's law prohibits anyone with any fault to approach God until that has been satisfied. Jesus Christ did that on the cross of Calvary. He paid the price, and now he offers salvation to you, full and free. He says, "Whosoever will may come." Whosoever will may come. Won't you come to him now? We'd love to pray for you. And if this message has shown you that there's no other way for you but by the way of the cross, we'd love to help you. If you'll drop us a line, we'll be glad to pray for you. We'll send you literature. We'll correspond with you. We'll help you to solve some of the problems that the devil may be putting into your mind. But now, let me lay upon your heart the necessity of making this decision now. God had shown to Israel the awfulness of his judgment on Mount Sinai, and then had come and presented them with the way of the cross as exemplified in this tabernacle. And there was no excuse for any to stay on the outside. Won't you now? As we come to the end of this message, bow your head and acknowledge before God that his estimate concerning your heart is correct. You're a sinner. You're lost. You're undone. And then lift your eye of faith to him and say, "Lord Jesus, save me now." Our Father, we claim the blessing of thy word in salvation in Jesus' name. Amen. And now for our second message on the tabernacle in the wilderness, will you take your Bibles and turn to the book of Exodus, chapter 24. The book of Exodus and chapter 24, where we read, "And he said unto Moses, Come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud, and gat him up into the mount, and Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. Before an individual can be saved, he must first learn that he cannot save himself. Adam, you remember, had to learn this tremendous lesson. After he had sinned, he imagined that he could get rid of his sin with a self-made garment of homemade fig leaf aprons. But God came down and ignored his flimsy fig leaves and pronounced the curse of death upon him and upon all his posterity and all creation. And then only it is that God showed him the only way of salvation by providing God's own remedy when he slew an animal and took the skins of the bloody victim and clothed Adam and his wife Eve with the substitutionary skins, Genesis 3:21. This is ever God's order. It has never changed. He kills before he makes alive. He first brings down before he brings up. He makes poor before he makes rich, 1 Samuel 2:6 and 7. This same order is followed in the giving of the tabernacle to Israel in the wilderness. The record of the pattern of this tabernacle is found in Exodus 25 to 31, six chapters. Its actual construction is not recorded until we come to Exodus 35 and is contained in 35 to 40. The instruction for the building, however, was preceded by the record of the giving of the law of God. Now, I want you to notice that. And then the record of the actual building of the tabernacle is again preceded by a repetition of the story of the giving of the law and the sad, sad record of Israel's miserable failure in the worship of the golden calf. Before God could bring the two tables of the law down from the mountain, Israel had already broken them and were already under the sentence of death and the judgment of God which the law demanded. Notice, therefore, carefully the order of the story in Exodus 19 to 40. Please do take your Bibles and turn to Exodus 19. In this chapter, in Exodus 19, and continuing all the way through chapter 24, we have a detailed account of the commandments and the statutes and the precepts and the laws which God enjoined through Moses upon Israel. These laws were designed to show Israel their utter inability to keep God's commandments or to be saved by their own righteousness. But poor, blinded Israel, in their depraved, sinful condition, deceived by sin in her own self-righteousness, supposed and imagined that they could keep God's law perfectly. And so we read. Now I'm reading in Exodus 24 and verse 3. Notice it carefully. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord has said will we do. Poor, poor, blinded souls. They stood before God's holy law and dared to say, we can keep that law. All the words which the Lord has spoken, we will do. How little they knew and understood and realized their own hearts and their own depravity and inability. But Moses recognized how blind they were, and so he immediately, after this foolish promise of Israel to be saved by their own works and by the perfect obedience to God's perfect law, he's quick to offer an atonement. Notice, therefore, carefully in the next verse, Exodus 24, verse 4. Exodus 24, verse 4. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord and rose up early in the morning and builded an altar under the hill, realizing that Israel could be saved not by keeping the law, as they had suggested, but only by the blood of atonement. He builds an altar immediately. And then the record continues in verses 5 and 7, Exodus 24, verse 5. And he sent young men of the children of Israel, which offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen unto the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. And he took the book of the covenant and read in the audience of the people. And they said, now listen, all that the Lord has said will we do and be obedient. Still they didn't understand the meaning of the sprinkling of the blood and the death of a sacrifice. When Moses read the law the first time, they foolishly said, yes, we can keep that law. We don't need a Savior. We don't need the blood. We can save ourselves by our own good works and obedience to and keeping God's holy law. And then Moses offers the sacrifices and sprinkles the blood to show the need for mercy and not for justice, that they could not save themselves but needed the blood and a sacrifice. If they had been able to keep God's law perfectly, as they assumed to do, they would have needed no sacrifice, no substitute, no blood. But they, again, missed the lesson entirely. And so Moses reads the law again to them with the same result. For again they say, all that the Lord has said will we do, and be obedient. And now notice the response of the Lord through Moses. Instead of God saying, all right, if they think they can keep that law and can save themselves, then you don't need any redeemer, you don't need any atonement, and so I'll just let you go. Ah, no, but we read instead. Listen, Exodus 24, 8. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people, and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. God's answer to Israel's foolish promise, all that the Lord has said will we do, is, behold the blood. Behold the blood. What Israel needed was grace, mercy, not their own righteousness and achievement. And then it is that Moses goes up again into the mountain and was in the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Now we've given you all of this preliminary introductory information to emphasize the setting, the occasion for the giving of the tabernacle. When Moses came down from the mountain, what do you suppose he brought back with him this time? Only the law? Oh, no. Something far better than the law. It was the pattern of the tabernacle, the picture of grace, the plan of salvation in the Lord Jesus, and glorious type of our substitute and redeemer, the tabernacle with its blood from top to bottom, end to end, from the altar to the mercy seat. I trust, therefore, that you have gotten the picture which God seeks to paint for us in this passage. When Moses went up into Mount Sinai, he received more than the tables of the law and the commandments, statutes, and precepts. Were this all that Moses had brought back, the story of Israel would have ended right there. For before Moses descended with the law, Israel had already broken its every commandment in the worship of the golden calf and were under condemnation. And the law, perfect, holy, just, demanded death and judgment of these transgressors. Had Moses therefore brought only the law down from the mountain, we repeat, the story would have ended right here in the total destruction of the nation of Israel. But thank God, in addition to the law, Moses brought back the blueprint for the tabernacle, God's wonderful provision for a sinful people, God's answer to a broken law, God's wonderful plan of salvation for hell-deserving sinners. And so, after the account of the law, Exodus 25 begins by telling us what Moses received in the mountain in addition to the law. Remember, therefore, and we emphasize this, that God gave to Israel through Moses in the mountain two things, not one thing, but two things, the law, which condemned and damned Israel and revealed their sin, and secondly, the tabernacle, which revealed God's only remedy for a people who had broken his law. The law, to show the awfulness of sin and man's desperate failure. The tabernacle, to show God's way out for the guilty ones who had broken his holy law. God gave first the law, which speaks of his justice, holiness, condemnation, and the penalty of death. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. Had God given no more than this to Israel, repeat again, she would have perished immediately. But the Lord foreknew Israel's failure. He foresaw their need of mercy. He knew they could not keep that holy law. And so he gave, in addition, the tabernacle, which speaks of mercy and pardon, forgiveness, atonement, redemption, salvation for all who would only admit that they cannot save themselves by their own efforts and works and by the keeping of the law, but by grace alone. Now this same identical order is repeated again in Exodus 32 to 40. After Moses had given the pattern of the tabernacle to Israel in Exodus 25 to 31, the actual construction is not described until we come to Exodus 32. But sandwiched between the giving of the pattern of the tabernacle in chapters 25 to 31 and the actual building and construction in 35 to 41, we have three chapters again recording how Israel broke that law and the giving of the second tables of the law, and then follows the actual rearing of the building of the tabernacle. We've gone into this detail, which may at first seem a little dull and uninteresting to some of you, but it is tremendously important in order to show the occasion for the giving of this tabernacle to Israel. It was God's revelation of his plan of salvation by grace and redemption through blood. But first, he must convince them how far short they came. He must allow them to prove their utter depravity of their own heart, convince them of their total corruption by proving the inability to be saved by the works of the law. And then only, are they ready for the message of grace. Paul expresses this very thing in Titus 3:5. Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. And so, before we take up in detail next week the study of the tabernacle proper, we want you to remember the setting, the occasion, why God gave to Israel two things in the mountain. First, the law, to condemn, to convict, to convince man of his own helplessness. And secondly, the pattern of grace, the tabernacle, to show God's remedy for sin, that they might turn from the law to grace, from Sinai to Calvary, from their own righteousness to God's righteousness, from their own doing to God's done. Paul says in Romans 8:3, "For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh." After some 3,500 years of human history, man still has not learned this tremendous lesson, but is still seeking by his own goodness and effort, by the keeping of the law, to be saved and made righteous in the sight of God. He insists upon resting upon his own morality, his religion, his law works to please God, and says again in essence with Israel, all that the Lord has said we can do, and thereby make unnecessary the grace of God. And so I want to emphasize before we close this message, which we consider very important before we study the detail of the tabernacle, I want to emphasize three words which Israel in her blindness repeated over and over again. They are, we will do. We will do. Do, do, do. That is man's vain dream, and has been ever since man first fell. He wants to do something in order to be saved. But God says, what you do will not do what you do won't do. Man's best, man's highest achievements come far short of God's lowest and least and meanest requirements. And so he sent his Son, the Lord Jesus, into the world in fulfillment of the type of the tabernacle, and he bore our sins and shed his blood. And now the message of grace is, it is done. It is done. It's finished. And this finished work of the Lord Jesus, fully developed in the New Testament, was already given in shadow and in type and revealed in the picture of the tabernacle, with its altar, its blood, its sacrifice, its provision for every need of the human heart. And so, in closing, we want to quote the Holy Spirit's own testimony in the New Testament concerning the tabernacle, the wilderness. Listen to it carefully. In Hebrews 9:19, you may want to follow it. Hebrews 9:19. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves and of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the testament which God hath enjoined unto you. Who, moreover, he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle and all the vessels of the ministry, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. And so the personal question is, have you learned the lesson of trusting only in the finished work and the blood of the Lord Jesus? There is no salvation until you quit working for your salvation. There is nothing you can do. It must be done by another. The sinner is hopeless and helpless to be saved by his own efforts, his own religion, his own merit, his own goodness, his own morality, his own righteousness. But he must come as a poor, bankrupt pauper, a hell-deserving, hell-bound, worthless sinner to the foot of the cross for the grace and mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul nails it down so that there can be no question about it when in Romans 4:5 he says, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Will you, my friend, learn the lesson? Will you cease resting in your own work and your own goodness? Have you ever come as a poor lost sinner, claiming nothing but the grace of God and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ? If not, won't you do it now? In these last few closing moments of this broadcast, which may be the last opportunity you will ever have, will you look into your own heart and see if you can find anything there at all that would satisfy God, anything that you could offer to him as an acceptable token? You'll have to admit, nothing, absolutely nothing, and then say, just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee. O Lamb of God, I come. I come, just as I am, and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to him whose blood can cleanse each spot. O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe. O Lamb of God, I come. I come. Will you do that? We're praying for you. I'm going to ask people all over as they listen to this program to pray for you as you make that decision now. And then, O Spirit of God, move upon the hearts of men and women who have listened to this broadcast today and help them to realize that their best is not good enough, that man's highest can't reach God's lowest, and that the Lord Jesus Christ himself has made provision and said on the cross, it is finished. It is finished. Oh, help them to turn to the grace of God today and to find peace, which was made by our Savior for guilty, hell-bound sinners. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.